Hey guys, we're here at Downtown Powerhouse in Tampa, Florida. We've got some special guests with us today. Stefi Cohen. We're gonna go through a little bit of benching today. And I think we're also going to take some time to look at deadlift setup and discuss how to deadlift and keep your back as healthy as possible. So we're going to lift some heavy weights and teach you guys some stuff. Let's get into it.
So I'm going to be benching today. The standing windmill is one of my favorite exercises to warm the bench. For many reasons, but a couple of them are, so one of the main muscles that's in charge of stabilizing the shoulder is your serratus anterior, and it's a muscle that's commonly neglected, mainly because you can't really see it. It stands from your ribs, and it attaches all the way onto the middle of your scapula, of your shoulder blade, and it contributes a whole lot to the stability of your shoulder blade. And if you think about it, your shoulder blade or your scapula is kind of like, functions as the base of your shoulder. So if you have an unstable platform or an unstable shoulder blade, then your arm won't be able to generate as much power, as much force as it could. In physical therapy, there's this quote that a lot of people keep repeating, it's proximal stability before distal mobility and control. So it follows kind of like that same logic of stabilizing at the midline, stabilizing, activating, strengthening the muscles that are closer to the center of your body so that the muscles that are distally in your arms can move not only more efficiently, but can produce more power. And then the second reason why is because a lot of people talk about shoulder stability or stability in general of different muscles or different joints, yet they don't train them well. So a good example is people just strengthening the rotator cuffs or activating the rotator cuffs before a bench. And it's great, you know, it's okay for someone that's post-operative, for example, to begin with the elbow really close to the torso, just do external rotations here really close, and maybe progress it to a 90 degree external rotation. But that's only training the rotator cuffs based on their action, which is external rotation of the arm, but it doesn't train it based on a function. The function of the rotator cuff, as far as the shoulder is concerned, is to approximate the humerus and to stabilize it. But you can't work on stability in the most congruent and stable position of your arm. You have to take your arm to an unstable position first, which would be high up in the air, and then you can work on stabilizing by putting it in an unstable position to be good first. So a good exercise to do is you squeeze your arm right here next to you, and then compare it to squeezing your arm at the top. You'll notice that you'll be able to produce a lot more force here at the bottom than at the top, and that just has to do with positions of instability. How many times a week are you benching?
When I'm training specifically, twice a week, and then I have another session which is an accessory, but it's usually slightly higher rep, lower RPE, but yeah, 2 to 3 times a week.
So the three of them are bench of some sort?
Yes.
Okay. And you, have you been making progress on that?
It was my slowest to make improvements. I only increased my one rep max by 7 pounds this year. And that was like with a good 3 months of just focus on.
So. How much attention do you pay to techniques? Like you take your time to like analyze your lift, look at it from a side, from a front, from a 45 degree angle?
A lot of the time I am training on my own. When I do get the opportunity to train with Layne, we usually do focus on like my lats, keeping my lats engaged. I'll notice occasionally I'll hit a little bit high, and then I'll make sure that I'm focusing on that for my next set, like repetition, making sure it's in the right spot. But that's probably it.
So a couple of things that I found helpful are, first of all, regarding to you, one thing that I did notice on your reps is that they're inconsistent as far as like the bar path between one rep to the other.
Yep.
So that's something that you can definitely clean up. In the bench, it's like similar to say like a snatch or a sumo deadlift, where if it's an inch off, you're done.
Yeah.
You know, it has to be the exact same
perfect
bar path.
Yeah.
Every single time, touch on the same part of your sternum every single time. Once you've mastered that, then you can worry about other things. But far as frequency. It's whatever you can tolerate and whatever you're, you know, without getting injured, and something that keeps you making that you can keep making progress in. So yeah. Like three reps is three sessions is good for you, then after that. And then a lot of focus on like upper back stuff. Okay. So serratus exercises, do you ever do those?
Yeah, a couple, not frequently.
Serratus punches, push-up plus. Windmills, like you do all those
sessions? I do windmills, yep. I do windmills in two of my sessions, yep. But the others, probably not. Okay.
And then a lot, do you do pull-ups?
Yep, definitely, always pull-ups.
Add weight?
Every weight.
Progressive overload,
say that again.
Progressive overload and pull-ups too?
Yep, so I've done, I started at rack pull-ups, then I progressed to regular pull-ups, then we do weighted pull-ups. I try to do different grip positions, so like every 8 to 12 weeks, I guess I'll change the grip position. So yeah, they're pretty frequent.
That sounds solid. And it's just your technique.
Okay, just technique?
Yeah, making it as efficient as possible.
Yeah.
Like for me, so I have 8 years of experience lifting weight, of which 4 were only Olympic weightlifting. So yeah. I didn't do any bench, but I did squat and deadlift.
Yeah.
And you can see like the discrepancy between how technically proficient I am in squatting and deadlift, just because I have 8 years of experience.
Yeah.
Versus bench, I have 3.5 years, 4 years.
Yeah.
Like, there is a visible discrepancy in technique proficiency.
Yeah.
So.
No, it's interesting that you mentioned like bar, because if anything that Layne ever picks up on, it's always, oh, you brought it down too high, you didn't hit the same spot.
Exactly.
So I guess, yeah, just repetitive motion, getting it in.
Okay. Is that as narrow as your, is that how you usually bench, or you're doing narrow grips?
No, that's how I bench.
You should try to like,
why?
Try different things. Yeah, you're not looking until October.
Right.
So we are in May. Yeah, do like 2 months of like trying
wider.
Like every like couple of weeks, just like go an inch wider, an inch wider, an inch wider.
Okay.
3 years ago, I used to bench here. This is so much.
Much more
range of motion.
Yeah.
Which obviously it's not the only thing when it comes to benching. Like there, some of the strongest bench pressers in the world have a narrow grip.
Yeah.
And they bench 600, 700. So yeah. Obviously it's not the only thing to take into account, but if you can save yourself some distance and save yourself some energy.
Yeah.
And if it feels comfortable to your biomechanics, and I don't see why not.
Okay.
It just has to be very slow so that you don't open yourself up for injuries.
Yeah, that's a really good point. Okay, I can definitely try that.
Tight. You were saying, Stefan?
One thing that I've noticed in bench press and girls, versus like comparing girls versus guys as far as benching goes, is that if you think about, when was the first time you bench pressed? How old are you?
14 years old, 15 years old.
What were you doing at 14? Definitely not benching. Right. Same for, I think, like maybe 99% of girls, we didn't touch a bench until we started doing powerlifting. Whereas guys, I would say that most of them at some point in their life went into the gym when they were like 12, 13, 14 and benched. So how many more years of experience do you have benching? And we get so frustrated, oh, we can't make progress. No shit, because we don't have the experience.
Yeah, I honestly would have touched it. The first time ever, I would have been 24.
Same for me.
Yeah, 24 years old was the first time I ever did a bench press. Yeah, it makes sense.
Is that a warm up? Have you ever met Eddie? He looks so weird. You know what I mean? Because his upper arm is that long, and his lower arm is like fucking that long. He looks like a gorilla. You know what I mean?
Yeah, he really does.
And his hands are this fucking big, and they're just fucking meat hooks.
Yeah, that might be what stood out to me the most. Shaking
his hands.
Like grabbing a bushel of bananas.
Yes. It's fucking ridiculous. It's so sexual. It was like an experience.
He's a brick with arms.
Yeah. That's racist, David. Oh. Yeah, she felt okay. Baby, you done here?
I
I did my first exhale and I saw your hair go, whoo! I was like, oh, she's gonna hate that.
Compound movements, strength and conditioning. One of my professors said that squat, bench, and deadlift should be done slow. That those are slow movements so you can generate more power and more force if you move slower because you can activate more motor neurons, you can produce more force.
I think it also depends on the person too. You know, some people are, obviously sometimes it's hard to say, like you can look at a, let's put anybody on blast, but I'll watch the way Dan Green deadlifts and I'm like, I would not teach it like that, right? But it works for him. But at the same time, you look and go, okay, but if you taught him how to do it, ideally, would he be better? Maybe, maybe not.
And then take the advice you're gonna give someone on the 0.001%, the exceptions, the outliers. Those are just freaks of nature, I don't know.
You look at a Bryce Lewis, I mean, Bryce just, boom, dive bombs his squat. But he also has short legs, he's almost completely upright, and his quads are enormous, right? So for him, it's harder for him to get out of position because he doesn't have as much to clear here, you know, whereas me, there's a whole lot of room where shit can go wrong, you know? So I'd rather kind of take it at a pace where I feel it, okay, I'm here, you know? Whereas if I just go here and now Like that's...
Yeah, some of your best reps have been when you've actually... I'm looking at you going, oh, you're doing an eccentric. And you're like, no, I'm just... this is just my... This is me taking my time with it. And you seem to perform a lot better when it's slower. When you rush, you get a lot of... Yeah, you're all out of sorts.
Yeah. Stu McGill did give me a nice compliment. He goes... Oh, you are not built to squat. He's like, you definitely got the most you could out of your frame. It's like, but you know, he did say, he was like, you know, it really wouldn't help you much to go wider based on the way your hips, you know, put together. And yeah, he's like, you know, he's like, we're some small tweaks we can make. And he did give me a couple of good cues that I've been using that seem to help. But yeah, it's like, you can't. People just lift so differently, you know, and I think people think, well, you got injured because of the way you squat. Well, maybe, I don't know, you know, there's no control group to compare that to, you know what I mean? Like, there's plenty of people who squat up. Bryce Lewis had a back injury. You would never look at Bryce and say, oh yeah, he's gonna hurt his back, right? So again, it's like, I think what I tell people is like, yeah, you probably should get as upright as you can, but that's gonna look different for everyone.
I think once you get past that point where you're at that level of athleticism, like, you're going to be training in that's the other thing, really fine line of pushing the limits.
People trying to sell you an injury prevention plan. There's no such thing. There's injury management and that's about it. And then perfect biomechanics don't guarantee that you'll be pain free, and that's the other thing that people need to understand. Most about the position that I'm in right now, which is to be able to travel a ton and speak to so many good coaches and good athletes, is that I get to learn from all of them. And so one of the things that I've promised to myself is that I'll always stay open-minded. You know, there's research and then there's practice and application, and sometimes they conflict and sometimes they converge. So I try to stay open-minded so that I could get the most out of my training and the training that I'm doing for other people. A good example is I recently went to Westside, and you know, a lot of people, some people have not so good, so many good things to say about Westside, some people have good things to say about Westside, but you know, for me it's a matter of just going there and learning as much as possible and just picking and choosing some of the things that I think could be beneficial for myself and for the athletes around me. So one of the things that Louis taught me while I was at Westside was the death march done on the belt squat. And that's one thing that I've added to my training that I felt like has been really beneficial, just for strengthening of the hip, of the glute med, more so for the purpose of endurance. So we add these about 3 to 4 times per week, where we do a 3-minute continuous effort march on the belt squat, just to strengthen the abductors, the glute med.
If you look at the lean, it pretty much matches the difference in these. I don't know if that's what it is, but I thought about getting an insert for my shoe, but then I was like, I've learned to walk, squat this way for however many years, I feel like it'd do more harm than good.
The example that I love to give people is, think about kids that have CP, for example. They have extremely aberrant movement patterns, mm-hmm. yet some of them experience zero, no pain
yeah.
in their day-to-day lives, even though they move really different to what you would consider the norm. So why would you think that a slight lean or maybe a slight discrepancy from knee to knee or from hip to hip would cause significant pain?
Yeah, so I think people always try to, like, that's what happens. You ever notice this when somebody gets injured? First thing is they try to find anything, and it's like a justification for why it won't happen to them almost, you know what I mean? Like Branch Warren tore his quad getting out of his car, and they're like, oh, have you seen the way he trains? It's like, we didn't fucking tear it in the gym, you know what I mean? Like, he tore, he slipped, getting out of his car. It could have happened to anybody. Oh, well, it's because he lifts so much weight. Well, maybe, like, you know, but it's just people trying to, like.
And then as a PT, for example, it's the pressure for a diagnosis. If I feel like you're coming to me, you're expecting an answer from me, a doctor level answer. And so some people just try to come up with whatever answers they can get because they know that you're expecting a diagnosis.
Yes.
But you know what? I came to the conclusion that I'm okay with not being like that and saying, hey, I don't know, or hey, here are 10 possible causes.
First mark of an expert is willing to say the magic words, I don't know.
Exactly. Dude, so listen important. To this. So my first rotation in graduate school, I had a clinical instructor that I asked him, I'm like, hey Jeff, his name's Jeff. Hey Jeff, sometimes people come with, say, shoulder pain, and I don't know what it might be. Like, I think it could be this, I think it could be that, I think it could be this, that, the other. And you know what he told me? He's like, Steph, don't worry about it. Just tell him whatever, give him an answer. And I'm like, dude, that's how you're gonna be treating people, just giving them whatever answer.
I could see it if it was
just
like,
that's right.
If you thought, for example, like if they were the kind of personality where they needed an answer, and then you said, but, let me give you an example. So when I went to Jamie for my hip, she said, you know, I'm not sure what's causing your pain, but let's get you moving better and see if the pain resolves.
That's great.
And I was kind of like, okay. So we tried it and it worked, right? But maybe I was the type of person who like needed an answer, and she could have said anything, but she said, okay, I think it's this, but you know what? If we do X, Y, Z, you're gonna get better.
That's a way better approach, because the diagnosis matters very little. Because how you treat it is gonna overlap so much between diagnosis and pathology.
Because 50% of Americans, if you MRI them,
have
bulging and herniated discs and don't have pain. So,
and it applies to other pathologies as well. It applies to the hip too. You see 37 to 43% of individuals who get an MRI would have some sort of hip pathology, labrum tear, or whatever.
That's like when I hear degenerative disc disease. You mean
same
old?
Thing.
Getting old?
You mean
or age?
Being alive?
Yeah.
Okay.
little more abduction, but yeah.
Are you ready?
Like that? Yep. Okay. That place is invite only though, isn't it?
Yes.
I got invited there by Chris Mason once. Yeah. It's just a completely different style of lifting. Like me, I just don't have the fucking time for it. That's the thing. Your 2 to 3 hours training sessions are going to turn into 3 and 4 and 5 hour training sessions. Yeah.
I might compete at the Arnold too.
Really?
That guy's fucking nuts.
Yeah. Are you talking about how you did a 3.5 year stint in juvie trying to get in because you didn't want to sleep? But that's when you learned to live. He's like, that was
an epic story. I'm using that story too.
Now, what's that?
Mendelsohn was talking on Mark's podcast.
What'd she say though?
She's like, I'm going to use that.
That's way better. That's so gangster. That's way better.
So badass.
You're like, I got picked on and wanted attention from girls.
Are you feeling like?
Working on that hashtag hate mask. You say I'm doing pretty good?
Yeah.
Huh. That makes me feel good. Usually I'm terrible. Things that are not squatting and deadlifting.
Did you pull on? Yeah, you need arms there, bud.
Oh. Where's the burn at?
Right in the upper outer glute.
From 1 to 10?
Probably about 7, but it's sustained. That's the difficulty.
You're facing this one.
I dare any motherfucker get that hating ass. Give me the hating ass. Oh. Sounds really good with the sound effects, doesn't it? And just because I'm gangster.
You're good. 3 minutes.
Yeah. I'm doing 3 minutes and 10 seconds. Because everybody stops at 3 minutes. All right, now I'm done.
How's it feel on your butt?
I feel like it's going to be like the treadmill where you get off and you feel like you're still wobbling side to... Oh yeah, that's a little weird.
That won't happen.